This podcast is brought to you by the Albany Public Library Main Branch and the generosity of listeners like you.
What is a podcast?
God, Daddy, these people talk as much as you do. Razib Khan's Unsupervised Learning.
Hey, everybody. So another episode of the Unsupervised Learning podcast. And I'm here with my old friend, William Gunn. William and I have known each other for almost 20 years now, at least when it comes to the internet, which is a little different than the real life. But still, you know, this is the 21st century. William, can you introduce yourself to the audience?
Well, hey, everyone. I'm William Gunn. I'm the head of communications at Quora. And a very long friend of Razib's, but still, like, it's probably the oldest acquaintance that I've never met in person.
Well, you live in the Bay Area, right?
That's right.
All right. So we'll make it happen after Delta's over, because I do go, to the Bay Area fairly frequently. And so we'll have a beer for old time's sake. But, speaking of old times, I first got to know you. I think you were at Tulane. You were doing, was it biochemistry?
It's molecular biology, yeah.
Molecular biology. So you're a molecular biologist by training. And the next thing I know, you're working for Mendeley. And then you went to Elsevier. And now you're at Quora. So you've been in this, like, quote, science communication game in a way, professionally for a while now. And I know it's been like, working at Elsevier, let's just say that you were at the center of a lot of drama. They paid you, like, that's the game you chose. So, you know, I don't feel sorry for you, but I know that it was kind of a difficult balancing act, I feel, because you are a liaison to the scientific community, and scientists have their own opinions, and they have opinions about corporations, and then you have the corporation you work for, and you got to be respectful and loyal to them. They're paying your salary. I mean, they're paying you for your job. So can you talk about, like, this kind of peregrination that you've had over the last, like, say, 15 years or so?
You know, if I had to go back and give a talk to people about how I ended up doing what I'm doing, it would not at all follow any of the traditional career advice or anything, you know. So I thought I was going to be a scientist. I thought I was going to be in a lab, you know, doing research. A lot of my colleagues are still in the lab doing research. But, you know, life sometimes just throws you curveballs, and it's how you ride them out, right? Does the wave, you know, knock you over, or do you surf it? In my particular case, it was the Hurricane Katrina, which came through New Orleans. When I was finishing my PhD.
Yeah, 2005 for the Zoomers out there, because they probably know a woman, they probably know a girl named Katrina, but they don't know the hurricane, so go on.
Yeah. Gosh, it's dating myself here. But yeah, so I was finishing up my PhD. We had to evacuate New Orleans. I ended up working in a collaborator's lab at the NIH for a little while, and then our whole graduate program, or the lab I was in, up and moved to Texas, while everyone was still kind of in this, hurricane diaspora. And that left me sort of like without a lab. So I was just writing up my PhD. I was done with all of my work, but I didn't have a lab. And there was really no reason for me to be there. And so I thought, well, you know, why don't I start looking for, you know, what I want to do after this? And, I was looking both directions. Like, there was some opportunities for me to do some postdocs, but then I got this offer, like, to come out for the summer and do a short-term consulting gig for this startup company, which I can now describe to people as Theranos, but real. And I just did that for the summer, thinking, you know, like, I don't have to be in New Orleans to write my dissertation. I can be, you know, working as a consultant and writing it up. Now, of course, anyone who's tried to write up a dissertation and have a full-time job at the same time probably guess, you know, where that led. But it got me interested in the industry side of things. And so then when Mendeley sort of came along, they actually, you know, reached out in this life science friend feed group for
most of the scientists will know what Mendeley is, but can you tell what Mendeley is to the non-scientists in the audience?
Yeah, so Mendeley is a tool for researchers to organize and share and collaborate around their publications and other people's publications. So let's say you have, you're writing about stem cells and you have published a few papers and you are trying to follow this particular niche that you're in. So you can go to PubMed and you can do searches and try to keep on top of the literature that way, but it's really, really hard, right?
Yep.
And so back at the time, we kind of thought, you know, there's like this thing called Last.fm, and there's, you know, Spotify wasn't quite around yet. But that, basically this concept of collaborative filtering, where we thought, hey, you know, if I'm reading like these papers, we should be able to have a system to say, like, other people who are reading these papers also read this other paper, maybe I should read it too. And so we kind of put together the system to do that. And then we realized, it's kind of handy for everyone to share like a citation library. So if you're working on a paper with someone, then you can automatically generate, a reference list, and your collaborators can do the same thing because you're sharing this reference library. And the UX of the existing reference managers were just terrible. So it was like, you know, a fish in the water to move into that space. And then there's all kinds of data products and things that came out of having a sense of who's reading what and kind of like how the attention to the literature is being allocated upstream of citations. Mm-hmm. And so that was kind of a fascinating thing there, which got me a little bit interested in sort of the whole meta science angle of things. And then, you know, after a few years, like you said, Elsevier came along, they acquired Mendeley, and I stayed with them for a little while. And then I moved on to working in a communications function at Elsevier more generally, because I had done a lot of the original like community development at Mendeley. And so it made sense for me to stay in sort of that communications community role. And what I thought I might be doing at Elsevier is helping the product designers at Elsevier, you know, get a clue about what researchers think. Because a lot of people don't know about Elsevier is they're not just a publishing organization. You know, they have all these information products for doctors and for nurses and for drug researchers. And also for people who like librarians and research admin, they want to know, like, if we recruit, you know, Dr. Bigwig so-and-so, is he going to be worth the salary, right? And that kind of thing. So there was valuable from a data point of view. And I thought I would be really useful, like, okay, so we can bring in Mendeley, we can bring in this new real-time data, you know, and maybe we can give them a competitor to the impact factor, which, you know, is from Thomson Reuters, is a big Elsevier competitor. But, you know, it turns out, and I can say this now, that Elsevier really has a hard time. I'm choosing my words diplomatically here.
Yeah, so yeah.
It has a hard time with a modern product development paradigm, especially like a user-centered one. I think they just kind of really couldn't get it together. And also, like, there's this all of this internal politics you face when, like, anything that you might want to do that, like, affects, you know, the publication business in some way, like that's just not going to happen. And then, and so it was a, it was my big hopes, my, you know, that going to Elsevier, we're going to be able to, like, you know, modernize the way they do it and really bring out some new things and get rid of the impact factor and bring in, you know, this great stuff. It's just too slow and conservative, and it couldn't get it out. That said, like, the whole institutional sales piece was a big part of it too, because, you know, if anyone out there is like thinking of building a, you know, an app for scientists to do something, it's, you know, look me up, come talk to me. I can tell you like how to not spend years trying to do institutional deals and ending up with nothing. So yeah, I mean, that's kind of took me through Elsevier.
Yeah, and so I mean, again, like the scientists in the audience, they'll probably, or the scholars will know what Elsevier is, but, or was, because it's got a new name and it's merged with something else. But I think Relex.
Yeah,
that's what
it's
called now. And so Elsevier, or like Relex, its revenue is £7 billion. Its income, operating income, so like, you know, I think that means like, you know, minus the cost, is $1.5 billion. It's got like how many employees? It's got a lot of employees. It's got 33,000 employees.
Yeah.
And so like the stuff that you're telling me, one, it's not surprising because you're old enough, you've seen things, but also you have a big social media presence on Twitter, and I could tell that you kind of, the whole time you were there, a lot of the times you were there, you're kind of on a knife's edge of just like, okay, you can't say anything bad about your employer, but you can see where people are coming from with some criticism. Is that correct?
You can totally see where people coming from with a lot of the criticisms. I also got to see, and this was, you know, it was a very eye-opening experience. And, you know, I'm under no, you know, legal or financial obligation to say anything nice to them at this moment. There are a lot of complaints and criticisms that come from people in the academic world that are just totally out of touch with reality, and that kind of fall in the category of like, you know, what we would call bike shedding, you know, just making a huge, huge, huge deal out of something that's really just a minor and not actually a big deal. Having at the perspective of seeing like here are the actual real problems, because I've been on all sides. I've been on the researcher side. I've been on like the the service provider side. I've been on the the publisher side, and seeing all of those pieces together, and seeing like, and then you know, frequently interacting with funders, you get a sense of like these are the things that really are screwed up about the research process overall. This is what I wish people would, you know, complain and mobilize about. And here are all of the things that people actually complain about.
Yeah. Well, so can you talk about, can you talk about like something that people complained about, and then like really they're just complaining to complain and maybe get a few likes, get a little clout on social media, but there's no follow through or anything. Because I know that it is easy to complain about the private sector and what academics call industry, but then actually following through and providing an alternative can be quite different. I mean, to give like a separate example, I know there was an issue a couple years ago about PLOS, or the Public Library of Science, which is kind of an alternative to Elsevier and traditional publishing, open, whatever. Their CEO had kind of a high salary. But I mean, CEOs have high salaries. It was kind of an interesting objection that people were making, because I mean, what are you supposed to do? Not have a CEO? It's not academia. It's an institution outside of academia that has a different pay structure, and it doesn't have academia's pay structure. It doesn't have academia's incentives, and it's just, people just were not internalizing that, from what I could tell. So can you talk about your experience at Elsevier, where academics were not realistic?
Well, I think the big place where you see that show up is where people don't have skin in the game, right? Mm-hmm. People will complain about being forced to publish or forced to do that, and like resent us because, you know, we publishers, like, we, you know, sit there and we control their destiny. Well, I mean, that's sort of overlooking the whole fact that, like, it's other researchers that sit on all the study sections, and it's the other researchers that are the peer reviewers, and it's former researchers who are, you know, the editors for the journals. And so, like, to talk about, I felt like a lot of the criticism was kind of like somebody complaining to Twitter because somebody tweets something at them that they don't like. You know?
Mm-hmm. But you're just a platform.
Yeah, it really is a platform. And I think, you know, the big, like, reasons that you don't see, you know, innovative new technologies being developed and cures getting out to patients and, like, the things that science is supposed to bring to the world, those have to do with, you know, some of these misplaced incentives that are part of the system, which you would think, like, okay, so, like, this is a... this is a thing that we need to fix it, but unless you can see the system from the perspective of all of the different parts, mm-hmm. you don't know how, you know, pulling or pushing one is going to affect the other linked parts.
They're seeing the outputs. They're seeing the outputs, and so they don't understand everything that needs to go into the inputs. I mean, in some ways, this might be almost like, oh, well, I could fix academic science by doing this, this, and this, and then it turns out that sometimes there's a rationale or a reason to some of the things that they do, and it kind of, like, falls apart, right?
Yeah. So if there's one thing that, like, I could get people to take from this is that, like, build it and they will come is not the thing that's going to work in science. There have been so many platforms that people have built to allow, you know, like, to get around, you know, the publishing hegemony and blah, blah, blah. Or to change, like, to get around the impact factor, to change how, you know, research, you know, metrics or, you know, how research is incentivized, and to get around publication bias and all of these things. And they've been built and nobody uses them because academia is super conservative, and building yet another one is not magically going to fix things. So I have this sort of idea that what academia needs.
Wait, well, before you keep going, I actually want to set you up for the listener who's not, you know, gone through academia. So I think what you're talking about here is, okay, like, what are academics producing? What is their output? Now, there are some academics that do public-private partnerships where they're producing something for the Mars Corporation or, you know, some engineering corporation. But a lot of times, if you're studying eyeless Drosophila, you know, using a genetic example, your output, your product is publications. And so this is how you get evaluated, how many publications you have, the quality and the impact of your publications. And so when you're saying people are conservative, this is a system that's been going on for almost a century, like a little less than a century, where this is how they're evaluated by their peers. And so people might complain about it, but this is the only system that they know. And, you know, when push comes to shove, they're not going to end up switching to something else unless they're forced to. So when you say build it and they will come, they're not going to. They're going to have to get forced probably to switch out of this system. It's one of those things where everyone's is unsatisfied with it, but everyone is stuck in the current system, and the first defectors are going to get penalized. This is even happening. This even happened with Mike Eisen's lab, where he only publishes in open access, but people who've left his lab, they end up publishing in the quote glam journals, you know, because you know, that you can tell them for 7 years or 5 years, this is what you got to do, but the incentives are really strong, and unless you're Mike Eisen, it's really hard to resist it. So I just wanted to set people up there.
Yeah, that's you're absolutely right. There are really, you know, attractors in academia that have a whole lot to explain for both the good side of what happens in academia, in that it can, like, resist political pressure and it can focus on the ideas as opposed to, like, having to think about the commercial outcomes are, you know, kind of being buffeted around by the, you know, the social whims of the moment. But at the, so that's the good side of the conservativeness. But the downside of the conservativeness is that we know that like peer review is broken. Like there's, it's holding together for now, but so many people are being asked to peer review so much stuff mm-hmm. that like there's this greater sense that like eventually it is not going to, it's just not going to be sustainable over over the long run. So but we can't change it.
William, talk about why peer review is broken. I mean, a lot of people are not going to index. So I can tell you, so for example, my friend Thomas Chatterton Williams, when I told him a couple of years ago that academics don't get paid for what they're published, you know, that they pay journals in many cases, he just was, his mind was blown. He had assumed that publications were paying for these papers. Talk about peer review. Talk about like how this publication process works a little for the listener.
Okay. So, and this is going to maybe blow some people's minds, but you think of an author as someone like you write and you publish this work and you get, if people buy your work and you get paid. It's not at all how it works in academia. In academia, like you get money from a funding agency because they think you are smart, are effective, or knowledgeable. And in exchange, like for you getting that grant funding, in exchange for you having the freedom to just, you know, spend this money and be smart, you are expected to publish. So the publication is an obligation that comes with like your accepting grant funding. And it's not like publication is in science, it's more like advertising the fact that you've done some work and it is not the work, right? There's because what you're basically doing is you're writing up a narrative summary of your work. It's not like a work of literature. That's why most scientists are totally fine signing over their copyrights to the publishing companies, because all they care about, once the paper is published, they're done, right? They, you know, they're not out there promoting it. It's not going to, the reputation that they get from publishing this thing and other people citing it, that's, you know, that's great and everything, but they care more about like where it was published and the quality of the, you know, the brand of the journal, which has some true aspects and some, you know, kind of BS aspects to it, than anything that happens after that. So they're really just taking all of the research they've done, the data they've collected, the experiments they've done, the observations they've made, and wrapping a narrative around it, and then announcing, hey, this is what I've done with all this grant money that I've had. This is, you know, and this is what I plan to do. So it's just it's totally different kind of publication from what most people think of. And there's been a lot of misplaced projects and design of systems in academia based on the idea that like scientists are authors, you know. I think, and you know, this never really got off the ground, but I would love to see like a publishing service where it's literally like a form-driven kind of interface. You upload your data, you upload, you know, like your figures, you upload your citations, you say what you want to have, you know, said about it, and then that platform can take those atomic pieces, you know, the narrative, the data, the code, the images, the citations, whatever, and render them in whatever format the consumer wants, whether it's, you know, through an API that goes out to some platform, or whether it's, you know, on the phone as, or, you know, as a PDF or an EPUB or whatever. And there's some projects that are leaning more towards that, but yeah, it's so far away from the traditional, you know, like authorship metaphor. The further away you can get, the better, I think, generally.
Yeah, it's a very exotic land where you take certain things for granted that are kind of the upside down of what you would expect. And then there's all these norms like your peer review. And then, you know, like, the weird things happen in this world where a friend of mine just early 30s. He's early career. He just got his first request to peer review his own paper. That's the first, yeah. This is a thing that happens because science is so specialized. There's only like, you know, there are fields where only 10 to 20 people are available to peer review, and that it gets to the situation where everybody is in the same pedigree. Like they come from the same, like, you know, grandparent, researcher, and it's just a weird situation.
So you mentioned, you know, why is peer review broken? And like, it's first of all, it's struggling under its weight because we're publishing more and more papers and people are, you know, getting more and more specialized, and it's harder and harder to find people to put in the time to peer review, because just like publishing is an expectation of an author, peer reviewing other people's papers is also, it's an academic norm. It's an expectation that you have as an author. And it worked really, really well when you had, back in the 50s and 60s, when you had much smaller, more cohesive kinds of academic disciplines. But now with these massive publication platforms trying to, you know, have a million papers peer reviewed a year, they just can't, you just can't find enough scientists to spend enough time to do a good quality peer review. And now that what that does is it puts a lot of work on the editors. So editors have to do a really good job of like keeping the peer reviewers in check, making sure they actually, you know, do the review. It's raised a lot of questions about like, what do we do next? Do we actually move to a stage where people just put their preprints, right? The publication that you write, but before an editor's seen it, before reviewers have seen it, or, you know, before it's been like made pretty by the things that publishers do, just put that up, in a repository, like, you know, archive in physics or bioarchive in biology or wherever, and then have the review happen after the things go up. It's a really attractive idea, but for one, you know, this old school conservative norm that like peer review is a thing that I'm supposed to do when a journal asks it of me gets more things reviewed than would otherwise. So if you think about the total pool of people that could review papers and how you spread them out across the total pool of papers that need reviewing, when you have a journal coordinate it and do it, it spreads it out a lot more evenly than if you take papers, you post in the bioarchive and people self-select, because you'd have some papers that get 200 reviews and some that would get none, right?
Yeah. So the Pareto principle kicks in where it's like 10 to 20% of the papers get 90% of the reviews.
Yep.
Yes. The journal, I see what you're saying. So what you're saying is like the journals are journals are making people eat their vegetables.
Yes. Yeah. They keep reviewers in check. Like I had to, and from the communications role, I worked really closely with our editorial team, and sometimes they would, there would be, you know, legal disputes among reviewers where like the reviewer thought he knew, where the author thought he knew who the reviewer was, and, you know, they like want to try to sue them, or they have try to pick a fight with them on social media or something. And, you know, it's the editors do a really tough and very much thankless job. People do not know how much like editors are keeping the whole like scientific communication process together with like bubble gum and duct tape in a lot of places. It is really a tough, thankless job that they do. And you might have two reviewers that are, one of them puts in a totally incoherent, you know, nonsense review. You might have somebody who puts in a nice review, but or a thought, a good review with a lot of good content, but does it in a nasty way. And the editors kind of have to like figure out how to take all of this input and do the best job in helping it improve the paper in the end. So yeah, there's, but it's not going to last. That's the thing that's fundamentally we're going to run up against, is there's just not going to be enough people to do that. Maybe we move to two levels. So like you can see someone doing a statistical review, where somebody else just looks at, you know, do these, you know, Western blots look right? Whereas somebody else goes through and looks at the experimental design and it's bucketed up that way. As opposed to whereas now, like you have, you get the PDF and, you know, you get a link to enter your review of the PDF. Some publication systems are asking for things in a little more of a structured format, but I think that is, that's going to have to change. I kind of had a hope for some of these like online annotation systems, like Hypothesis, to really boost how people can do review, because you're not like reading this thing and then kind of talking about your thoughts, but you can pick out certain specific things, saying, you know, this particular like lane in this Western blot is, you know, looks funny to me. And it, you can review a paper in more detail a lot more quickly that way. So you can bucket it out that way. Or what you can move to, you know, is a system that, and I'm laughing as I say this because I know how much of a mess that is from the back ends from Matt. But something that looks more like moderation on social media sites than peer review, where you've got like, you have this big platform, like let's say BioArchive goes and talks to, you know, SoftBank and says, hey, you know, give us $100 million to own biomedical publishing. And SoftBank says, yeah, here's $100 million, come back to us next year when you've spent it all. And they basically like say, we will pay, you know, we will outbid everyone for all of the reviewers in, you know, in biomedicine, and just bring them all on the onto that platform to review all the things. That might be the sort of thing that happens, where in which case I think it's going to start to look more like moderation.
Wait. Are you talking about bio Reddit? I mean, it's like basically you're saying like scientific publication could be replaced by Reddit. I mean, not, I'm being glib, but you know what I'm saying.
Well, so here's a kind of a metaphor that I've been tossing around, that's particularly salient to me, because of the work I've been doing at Quora lately. Is like, if you think about Quora and you think about Reddit, Reddit is a forum where everyone's kind of on like, you know, equal standing. At Quora is more like, it has more like a, you think about like a Quora space, it's more like a platform, you know, stage and, you know, audience kind of a metaphor, which is more like, imagine you're at a scientific conference, somebody's up on stage, they're giving a presentation, you know, but there's people in the audience that can ask questions and, you know, discuss amongst themselves. I feel like that metaphor probably works better just from like the affordances that you have in the interface, than the sort of like egalitarian, just let's all get together and discuss things sort of concept. But something like that. Yeah, totally. It's,
Okay, so I got to ask about Quora. You know, I think most of the listeners know what Quora is. You know, I'm just going to like, this isn't a video, so they don't know. You are a white male. I thought everyone associated with Quora was now Indian.
Well, so this is the really interesting thing about Quora that I've learned, is that, you know, Quora has... has Adam D'Angelo, former, you know, CTO from Facebook, has lots of, you know, some of the best machine learning talent in the world for a while. Like, and as far as I know, this is still the case. There are engineers who will turn down jobs at Google or Facebook to go work on the machine learning team at Quora, because there's just such interesting problems and such good talent that's there. Because they have all of this, the site is extremely like tailored and customed to whoever it is that show up.
Well, yeah, so actually, no, I gotta be. I assume everyone knows what Quora is, but just like tell the people what everyone is Quora is, so that before, you know.
Right. So Quora is a platform to for people to share their knowledge. So there's you can go to Quora and you can ask a question and you can like get specific people who use Quora to respond to your question by sending them a request, and you actually get a little a blurb about what their expertise level is, and the system can recommend you the people that are both most likely and most able to respond to your question. And this is where the parallel with peer review is really, really interesting, because journals, the reason peer review is breaking down like and not able to handle the load is because they reach out to the most qualified people, but they have no way of knowing what the capacity of those people are. And mm-hmm. so it's fascinating to see that like on Quora, you actually have data on like, not just can this person, are they qualified to answer the question, but like, are they likely to answer the question if, you know, if it's asked to them at this particular time of day, you know, or whatever. And so, mm-hmm. So you can get, you can answer us back that way. We also have a product called Spaces, which, you know, again, kind of, a, you know, think about going into a conference room. There's somebody up on stage presenting. There's people that follow the groups, but it's more about the owners and contributors of the space curating questions, writing posts about a specific topic or, mm-hmm. or you know, thing that they have a focused interest in. Mm-hmm. And so, that's the way that kind of like Quora presents all of these different faces to whoever shows up. There's a huge like K-pop fandom on Quora, which I never see, but it is like if in my use of the site, but if I go and look at kind of, you know, the back end traffic and stuff, it's huge. You know, there's obviously like a huge Indian user base on Quora, but I mostly don't see that stuff in my feed, because, you know, I'm following science spaces and some like, you know, wine making spaces and things mm-hmm. like that. And it's just not something that pops up a whole lot. They use it very differently. You know, they use it kind of more like a, you know, like a Facebook or something. And it's kind of more social and they're posting.
Yeah, Quora is for Indian people, Quora has become a social media thing, right? I mean, this is what my understanding.
Yeah.
And so they have like just like whole zones of Quora are basically colonized by them. But you're saying that there's a lot of separation with all these communities.
Right. You go on there and you like, you tell Quora what you're interested in, follow some spaces, follow some people, and it learns from your activity, what you upvote, what you downvote, you know, what you mute, et cetera, what to start showing you. And you get this, your experience of Quora is totally different from like everyone else's, which really makes it kind of hard from like a communications perspective to talk about Quora, because what I see is so different from what everyone else sees. And just like with, you know, all of the complaints I would get from Twitter about people saying, oh, you know, Elsevier is this, you know, research is broken for this or that reason, just speaking from their perspective. You get all these complaints from Quora of people saying, oh, this is broken because it's broken for them in a specific way that they've started to use it. So it's really interesting. But
you know, I go to Quora every now and then. Well, I mean, it just comes up in searches and I read it. And so I've actually never gone to Quora. I mean, I have an account. I'm logged, signed in, but I've never mm-hmm. gone to Quora. Not that I know, except for like when I'm searching for something, like sometimes like there's a lot of things where actually my name comes up where mm-hmm. people like will cite my blog post or something like that. Just like I'm curious what people are saying, because that's mm-hmm. you know, curious what people are saying about me, right? But so like I've just like started to explore this like while we're talking. And so yeah, like people should definitely check this out. This looks interesting. And you know, my friend David Middleman, who you probably know of, like he's always been fascinated by Quora and what they're doing with information. And so I guess like, you know, this is kind of like a segue to the next topic that I want to talk about, like meta science, communication, you know, like obviously you have your professional interests, but I've always felt like you, you know, like you follow I mean, you follow like Star Codex, like, you know, Scott Alexander, this sort of stuff. I think you think deeply about how information is coming out of there. And so you said something about the reproducibility crisis that you were having a discussion with someone many years ago. And it was a little disturbing, like your ultimate conclusion. But can you talk about that a little?
Yeah, so obviously I can't leave the topic of Quora without mentioning that we just launched monetization features, so you can now get paid for answering questions and having spaces, as opposed to doing it, you know, out of the goodness of your heart. But yeah, the reproducibility initiative. I worked with the Center for Open Science, which is a meta science. An organization that kind of got started.
Is that Nozick's thing?
Yeah, Brian Nozick's thing. And you know, he kind of got a lot of his start around the crisis that psychology was going through, where there's just so many of these fundamental things that they had been publishing and building on turned out to just be phantoms and not really based on a solid evidence base. Some of it was, you know, almost like, you know, line sync, and some of that stuff was deliberately fraudulent. But they were interested in funding other meta science kinds of initiatives outside of the social sciences. So myself and the CEO of the startup called Science Exchange, which is an outsourcing platform for getting scientific experiments done, so you can have a virtual lab and that kind of thing. And I think they've pivoted a little bit away from that to working more with like pharma now. But at the time, it was kind of like the Airbnb for scientific instrumentation. You know, you have like your flow cytometer in your research group probably isn't at 100% utilization all the time. So like maybe that a particular instrument can take in outside work. You know, maybe the person who runs it can take outside work and get paid to run it in the, you know, the idle time. That was kind of the idea. Anyways, like, so you have an ability to do research, and then you have, like, from my side, interested in about research metrics and reproducibility. Like, here are all of these things that are really, really highly cited in biology. I wonder if they're true. And there have been some, you know, there were some papers published looking at, you know, breast cancer biology, looking at ALS, looking at, you know, cardiac interventions, saying like, look, you know, we're just really struggling to build on this preclinical research to come up with a drug or a therapy that like actually makes a difference for patients, because we have all of these papers with hundreds and hundreds of citations elucidating the mechanisms by which this disease occurs, but none of the like drugs actually work. And so like, what is it that we're not getting here? And so I thought it'd be interesting to go and take some of those research papers and run them and like redo the experiments, break the papers into pieces, send off like, you know, okay, you know, Western Colorado, you know, flow cytometry facility. Hey, will you go isolate this population of cells and stain it with these markers and, you know, just give me the data back. And then you work with another organization to do, you know, some histology and just kind of go through these papers, regather the data, but from a widely spread group of labs, none of whom really know what each other's doing, which means none of them have that publication bias where they're like, we're going to suppress, you know, some findings, or we're going to, you know, like edit the data a little bit, or we're going to keep running the experiment to get the finding that we want. None of the left hand doesn't know what the right hand's doing. And is that going to come out with a different set of results? Now, obviously, to do all of this work, it takes a lot of money. And I was running around trying to fundraise, and I spoke to, you know, like the assistant director at the NIH, and I said, hey, you know what? Like, the NIH should be funding a lot of this stuff, because you're dumping in unknown amounts of, you know, billions of dollars. And for listeners who don't know, the NIH funds 99% of biomedical research in the U.S. It's not the pharma companies. It's not, you know, the industry of any sort. That's just
a biotech, tiny
minority. But I was talking to him and I said, look, I mean, how much further would these billions of dollars that you're allocating to basic research go if you shaved some of it off to do some like meta science to understand how to make the research that you're doing more, that you do more effective? And he said, you know what, that's a really good idea. I wish we could do that, but we aren't going to like make a whole lot of noise about the fact that our research is not really reproducible, because that's really going to feed in all of the denialists and cranks and the people like the anti-vax people you have today, or the climate denialists or whatever. And so it was just like, it was a great idea. He thought it would like really move the science forward across all the fields that they published, but it was just too much of a political hot potato for him to touch. And I thought he was wrong. I was like, no, this has got to, you know, like, how can you be so short-sighted? This makes research better. We ended up getting some funding. We worked with the Center for Open Science and one of their funders is the Laura and John Arnold Foundation. They contributed some extra money. We were able to get this stuff funded, but nowadays, you know, hearing just like what COVID has really made extremely salient to me, and I think a lot of people, is that, you know, Larry Tabak was right. The people don't trust the NIH. They don't trust the CDC or the FDA. And this distrust, you know, feeding distrust among people who think they know enough to know better, but actually don't, actually does more harm in the long run. And it's that's a real, real bitter pill to swallow. In that Twitter thread, you know, there's lots of people who are really just kind of making my point. And that's not to say that people don't have valid reasons to distrust some of the things the CDC has said. They got some things wrong about the aerosols and such. But the overall point is that trusting these people to do a good job on the things that they're doing, outsourcing your thinking to them, for most people who don't have the ability to dig into the primary literature and figure things out for themselves, or even the people who do but whom just don't have the time to do it, it's a better use of your time. It's, you're better off overall trusting them, even though they're wrong occasionally, than it would be to just say, oh, they were wrong about this one thing, therefore they can't be trusted, I'm going to throw out everything they said.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, I mean, on the high level, I agree with you. But I do think that there is some differences with, say, COVID-19 and, I don't know, it's like too much of an analogy, but say, like, the selection neutralism debate in evolutionary biology. Like, that's been around for 50 years. There's a lot of data. There's been a lot of, let's say, epistemological, like competition between theories and models and hypotheses. I think the problem, like, let's talk about COVID-19, because, you know, this podcast, like, I try to make it evergreen. So I guess this is going to be, like, not as timely if someone listens to it 5 years from now. But you know what? That's fine. I think the issue with COVID-19 is this is a new thing. And a lot of people had priors and base rates. So, you know, I was worried in early February. And I can tell you, one, all of science Twitter was ignoring it. And two, you know, you'd be called a Sinophobe. And, you know, why do you care about this? Is it because it's from China? Like, are you a xenophobe? And so, like, that was like, and like, you know, even until like, actually, like, on February 24th, you know, I got a DM from a friend, and I'd been getting direct messages on Twitter from a friend about, like, what do you think? And I'm like, I think you should hunker down. You should be scared. Like, stuff's going to come down the pipeline. And finally, I just decided, you know, I don't care if I seem crazy. I tweeted out, like, you know, I tweeted out my response, and I had multiple scientists tell me, like, oh, okay, I was thinking the same thing, but no one's saying it. So I thought maybe I was crazy. And so, like, you have this, like, whole thing where I think, okay, the authorities seem, and like, you know, like the whole mask thing, the mask flip, the aerosolized thing. And like, this is like, scientists get mad about this because they're ideologically pretty uniform. No conservative is going to listen to public health after the whole BLM thing, because they were not saying any of the same things when there were the people protesting earlier. In fact, they were like criticizing them, making fun of them, saying that they're a public health threat. And then they say, well, this is more important than that. I'm like, okay, I got it. Like, I mean, if you're a conservative, you got it. You know, like, when push comes to shove, their politics is more important than their science. So this is, I think, like, I just want to say, like, there's special things with COVID-19 that made it kind of, and in other countries, it's not as culturally polarized, by the way. A lot of these issues are not as culturally polarized. They do have protest movements in places like Germany and Australia about the lockdowns, but it's not as ideologically polarized. You know, in Israel, it was a conservative government under Netanyahu that was doing the lockdowns, and a lot of the labor people, but also the ultra-Orthodox Jews were angry. So it's mixed. The United States is a very special country in a lot of this polarization. And so I just wonder if, like, with COVID, we're kind of seeing a situation where, you know, trusting the authorities. I mean, if you trusted the authorities on masks, which a lot of people did, nobody bought masks, you know, except for people in the know. Like, I had friends who got N95s and other stuff early because they were just, this is BS, you know? So I don't know. I just got to put that out there, because I think, like, you know, when people say, like, they don't believe in evolution, well, that's different than saying, like, they don't believe the droplet theory of, you know, whatever. I mean, cause, right, like, yeah. hygiene theater is still going on. People are still proudly saying that they're doing deep cleaning, even though it's totally useless. And we've known this for over a year, probably.
Yeah, no, you're absolutely right that the CDC blew the thing on masks. And, you know, like, we, you know, I wasn't there. I don't know that the conversations that happened, they said the wrong thing. One thing that I do know from, like, a spokesperson's perspective is that, like, the number of people that hear what you say directly is maybe, like, you know, 1/100th or 1,000th of the people that will hear your message. So what you do when you're putting out a message is that you try to think of all of the ways, all of the different people that are going to hear it, all the different ways it's going to mutate as it moves along. And you try to come up with a message where the core thing that you're trying to say will make it through all of those, you know, all of those mutations. And you obviously, like, there's so much you just can't know, and some people are better at it than others. They could have been a lot more clear about the mask thing. They could have been a little bit more early. I think the BLM stuff doesn't show the hypocrisy really of the CDC, I think, so much as all of the media and the coverage around it.
Well, I mean, there were 1,000 public health professionals that signed, you know, I mean, you know, it's not just I think the media and the academia, like, I mean, concretely, when Trevor Bedford wrote about the possible risks from the BLM, he was pretty frank that he was kind of scared to do this.
Yeah. And he should have been, right? Because people are not in their right minds. And I think when you combine the fact that, like, someone's not in their right mind, they're extremely emotionally motivated, they don't have all the information. Well, if you're in that state, shouldn't you be kind of thinking twice before thinking that you know that you're going to second guess, you know, an authority figure? Like, obviously they're wrong about some things, but if you sum across all of the things that they have said, they're probably right more than they were wrong, and they probably would be more right than you were you're the ones making all the same decisions they did, right? That I think is,
yeah.
You know, that's what it comes down to.
Yeah, and, like, you know, in the defense of the authorities, you know, I mean, most doctors were totally wrong because they were subject to base rate fallacy, but you should still go see your doctor. You know?
Yeah. I mean, it's like picking stocks, right? You know, everyone thinks they can beat the market. And occasionally you can. Like, I bet on Moderna when it was cheap and did, you know, beat the market there. But, like, if you sum up all of my decisions, you know, all of my investing decisions over my life, it's probably going to be about the same as if I had, you know, chucked it all in, you know, a market tracking mutual fund, just because that's You know, I don't have any special knowledge. I had a little bit of an edge when it came to Moderna because I was like, oh, I can see how this would be a platform. And I think that their early clinical data is actually looking pretty good, you know. So I had a little bit of an edge there. Where you do have an edge, right, then, yeah, second guess all you want, right? Like, I think most people don't have an edge in all areas. So that's kind of where you have to have some, like, epistemic humility. And, again, when people are really, really emotionally riled up, they're not in their right minds, they're doing things like, you know, going out in the street and chanting in mass crowds in the middle of a pandemic, right? That's not a thing that you do when you're, like, you know, calm and rational and, you know, considering all of the, that it's a decision made from emotion. I'm not judging it one way or the other,
yeah,
but it's an emotional decision. And if you're doing that, you're not in your careful, let's consider all the best, you know, evidence and make the, you know, the best decision we can about other aspects of your life too. You know, that's why they say don't, you know, invest when you're, you know, when you're hungry or when you're upset, right?
Yeah.
Because you're not going to be making the best decisions. And so I think knowing when it's okay to outsource your decision to other people is a skill that skeptics particularly need to practice, because their priors are like, you know, I'm being lied to and these people are misinterpreting it, or they're telling me something that they're motivated to tell me, you know, like, and that's where you get all of this denialism and skepticism about, like, oh, it's just, you know, the drug lobby is telling us that, you know, like chloroquine is not going to work because it's cheap and there's not a patent on it or something, right? And so, like, you really, really have to be careful. If you want to be a skeptic, you have to be particularly careful to know when you should trust the authorities. And that's really, really hard for people to do who are just kind of in this, like, default skepticism state.
So, you know, I guess the last question, well, I mean, I think I know what you're going to say, but I mean, are you optimistic in terms of building a better world through knowledge and information? Like, do you see things changing in our lifetimes? Like, I mean, does it get better? We're having a lot of stuff about disinformation and you know, all these memes and the denialism, as you say, which is, you know, a term that goes back about 20 years now. And, you know, I don't even want to go into all the conspiracy theories that are out there, but I mean, there's a whole, you know, culture around stuff like QAnon and anti-vax and all these other things. So, I mean, are you still optimistic?
So, I struggle. I think overall, I'm optimistic that, you know, humanity will pull through. Over, you know, our trajectory looked over, you know, a long enough time frame has generally been up and to the right in terms of all kinds of metrics. This is where, like, Orwellian data is great, kind of like, you know, palate refresher to look at, because things are getting better. You know, childhood mortality is going down, and, like, you know, the rate at which, you know, we're dying of, you know, car crashes are down, you know, violent crimes going down. All these, we're generally overall doing better. But the thing about this is that this isn't a thing that just happens, and it isn't a thing that everyone is uniquely capable of making happen. There are specific people who, you know, feel a calling to make a difference in a certain area, and they answer that call and they really devote themselves to doing it. And those are the ones that make the difference. It's easy to think that with, like, these, in the day where we have these, like, massive Twitter hordes that will descend upon, you know, the evildoers and, you know, cancel them for whatever, you know, mischief, that, like, you... That,
oh, I know about those.
Yeah, so do I, trust me. But I imagine, you know, a lot of listeners here can identify. But the thing is, it's easy to kind of, like, let the bystander effect come in, and you think, oh, well, like, I don't need to do anything because, like, there's just going to be, you know, like, somebody will take care of it, or, the government, you know, there's agencies whose job it is to do these things. And if you trust the authorities, maybe you think, like, yeah, I shouldn't. So that's kind of the flip side of what I wanted to say is, yeah, trust the authorities. But if you feel called to do something and you have enough epistemic humility to know what you know what you don't know, and this is a thing that you feel like you are uniquely qualified in some way to contribute to, then you have to jump on it, because it's the people who have found that calling and took the opportunity that have made the difference every single time. And if we can get more of that, then that's what I'm really optimistic about.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. All right. It was great talking to you, Will. I'll see you online and IRL hopefully soon. As we're recording, we're having another wave, and I think hopefully by the time this is posted, we'll be done with that. Trying to look on the bright side of things. We live in a world of information. Your company Quora is trying to navigate through it. I think that's great. We live in a world of information that's transformed in the 20 years we've known each other, been online, and it's, some of it's for the good and some of it's for the bad, but we just need to figure out how to optimize things. And I do appreciate your Pinkerite viewpoint, that it's getting better, that we can have enlightenment, and we're putting the past behind us. So hopefully I will see you soon, and thank you for your time.
Thanks so much for having me.
This podcast for kids.